If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Daniel. It's in the Old Testament, book of Daniel, chapter 1, verse 1. And as we saw last week, that Daniel is basically, it says, when Daniel wrote it, it says, seal it up. God said, seal up this book, because it was really written for us, for kind of in the last days. And so now that we're in the last days, this book, it helps explain to us what is going on, helps to explain to us the book of Revelation that a lot of people don't understand. So it's a very important prophetic book, probably one of the most important prophetic books we have. The title of today's message is Set Apart Like Daniel. How many know we need to be set apart? I mean, sanctified. We need to be set apart for God. And in this day and age, the word to be defiled, which would be the opposite of being set apart, means to be mixed. It means to be polluted. It means to be stained. And how many know, sadly, the church of Jesus Christ in America has been stained a little bit. Amen? It's been polluted. You see pastors in great sin. You see, you know, and they say as leadership goes, so goes the church. And so the church has been stained. But hear this. God says he's coming back for a church without spot or wrinkle. He wants us in these last days, rather than to continue in the ways of the world, that we would be set apart and sanctified by Christ. Amen? How many are getting tired of the world and the ways of the world? Amen? I'm starting to get tired. The older I get, the more tired of it. You know what I mean? At one time, before I was a Christian, I thought the world had all the answers. But as I gotten older, I realized it just pretends to have the answers. But we know we in Christ have the answers. Well, I want to tell you a quick story that I heard this week, since it's Christmas. Once upon a time, a perfect man and a perfect woman met. And after a perfect courtship, they had a perfect wedding. Their life, of course, was perfect. One snowy Christmas Eve, One snowy Christmas Eve, this perfect couple was driving their perfect car, an SUV, along a winding road, and they noticed someone at the side of the road in distress. And being the perfect couple, they stopped to help. There stood Santa Claus with a huge bundle of toys. Not wanting to disappoint any children, on Christmas Eve, the perfect couple loaded Santa and all his toys in their vehicle, and soon they were driving around delivering the toys. But unfortunately, as they were driving, the conditions got really bad, and the perfect couple and Santa had an accident, and only one of them survived the accident. Now, who do you think survived the accident? No, the perfect woman. She survived because she's the only one who really exists in the first place. Everyone knows there's no Santa Claus. And everyone knows there's no such thing as a perfect man. So if there's no perfect man and no Santa Claus, then the perfect woman must have been driving, which then explains the accident. Hey, I figure if Kevin could do it, I could do it. Amen. So there you go. Well, let's pray before I get any more trouble. So, Lord, we thank you so much for your love. And we thank you that we can laugh, we can smile, we can have joy, but Lord, we can also be serious. And I pray that this message would be anointed by you, amen, that your Holy Spirit would just speak through me, that Father, it would not be my words, but it would be your word taught with the power of your Holy Spirit. I pray that your conviction would be here, that those who need to be convicted would be convicted. Those who need to be encouraged would be encouraged. Those who need a little pat in the butt would get that, Lord. Whatever is needed here, I pray that everyone would be touched by you. Everyone would leave this place saying, God is in your midst. God is here. God spoke to me. God touched my heart. And so, Father, I pray that you right now, I give you myself. And I say, Lord, let me be, as it says in Peter, an oracle, a mouthpiece for you, that you can speak through. I pray, Father, for everyone here, whether it be in this room right now, the sanctuary, or in the foyer, or on the internet, anyone listening, I pray that you would now open their spiritual ears. And that, Lord, as you said, why are you so dull? Lord, quicken their minds. Quicken our minds to hear what your Spirit is saying to us. And may we, Lord, not be just hearers of your truths, but may when we hear a truth that our life is not in line with, that we will yield to it. We will say, Lord, help me to be a doer of your word. Help me to be someone that obeys what I should do. And so, Father, that's your heart, is not just hearers only, but be an effectual doer. So, God, let us be a church that allows you to clean us up, allows you not just to save us, but to wash us, to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So, Father, thank you for that. And I pray that you would have your way right now, that all distraction would be bound, and your Holy Spirit and your word, that you would be able to speak to us, and we would be forever changed. We ask this and believe for this in the mighty name of Jesus. And everyone agreed, said,
amen.
Amen. That was a... I want to ask this real quick. Why is it, I'm going to say this, and I don't mean to be mean, but that's just a gift I have. But we go to a football game or basketball game, right? Woo! But then I say, hey, amen. You're like, amen. Come on, guys. This is the house of God. We can say amen. Can we say a loud amen? A heart? Like pretend you're at a football game, amen. Amen! Woo! There you go. That's it. Now, see, I think the Lord likes that. Amen? He says in heaven it's going to be like the sound of my... We've had people complain about the sound. How many know heaven's going to be a pretty loud place? It's going to be the sound of... His voice is like the sound of many rushing waters. Have you ever been under a waterfall? I went to Oregon and you could go underneath this huge... You remember that? You remember? There's this huge waterfall and you just... It's like you go, hey, how you doing? Because it is so loud. How many know heaven is not going to be just a bunch of little chubby angels, you know, floating around, shooting arrows at people? That's not heaven. Amen? It's going to be joyous. It's going to be loud. It's going to be exuberant, and we need to be that here. Amen? So heaven doesn't freak us out. Amen? So we're ready to go. All right, Daniel chapter 1. Does that, you still love me for that? Because sometimes you guys go, oh, don't you tell me how to act. Well, I just think, how do I say this? If I was God, I would be jealous of how we act at football games. Amen? Or basketball games, because I think we get a little more excited about something. And how many know, those football players don't care about you. Okay, they really don't. They just want you to pay and get their money, but they don't care. How many know, Jesus cares about you. And you should shout more for him than anyone else in the whole world, amen? And he likes your shouts. He likes an amen. He doesn't like the, hey, amen. Yeah, praise the Lord. Yeah. Unless you can't speak loud, you should get excited, all right? I've torqued enough of you off. I better move here. Verse 1 of Daniel. In the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it or conquered it. So carnal was King Jehoiakim, the Israel king, the Judah's king, that when he received a scroll of prophecy from the prophet Jeremiah, he chopped it up, and as he was as one of his scribes were reading it, he chopped it up and threw it in the fire. As he is believing that he could invalidate the word of God. But Jeremiah, being the man of God that he was, simply sought the Lord for another copy. And that's found in Jeremiah 36:23, if you want to study it later. This time, when he got the new copy, Jeremiah, the Lord added a few things that were pointed directly at Jehoiakim. How do you know it's not good to chop up the word of God? And because of his stubbornness, Jehoiakim was told by the prophet Jeremiah that Judah, his kingdom, would be besieged. It would be conquered by the Babylonians. And that they would be carried away captive. And they would be carried away captive for 70 years because of their disobedience and propensity towards idolatry. How many know that should concern us as Americans today? Amen? God allowed them because, not because there was some stronger guy that wanted to attack Judah, but because of their disobedience, God allowed the Babylonians, he allowed Nebuchadnezzar to come and conquer them. How many know we deserve to be conquered? And we have people that would like to conquer us, amen? We are called the great Satan. And you know what I mean? 2/3 of the world, what is it, 2 billion Muslims? How many know a lot of them would like to conquer America and have Sharia law here? Amen? Did you realize that? Hear this. I know you don't like this stuff, but I just say it. Do you know that 50% of Muslims that live in America want Sharia law? 52%. Does anyone have a problem with that? Do you understand that when people used to come to America in the old days, they wanted to be American, be part of the American culture, freedom. Now what's happening is people are coming in wanting to change America. How many know our own president said that? I'm going to radically change the face of America. That's one thing he has done. But how many know that Sharia law, how many know this? I think it's funny that liberals love this, right? Freedom. We're not going to be Islamophobic. We're not going to say anything about it. How many know Islam is not real good for women. Amen? If you say, oh, yes, it is, well, you better get your head covering on right now and be silent, woman. How many of us are not good for Christians? And so we need to know that we need to respect all religions, but if a religion is tried to overcome by force and kill people, how many know that's not a religion we should allow in America? Amen? And we need to say that. We need to lovingly agree to disagree, but firmly disagree and say, you know what? We're not cool with that. We're not so open-minded that our brains have leaked out. Amen? And so we need to know that. So, but I say that to say, just to, you know, frustrate you. No, I say that to say that notice it was because of their rebellion against God, the leader's rebellion against God, that God allowed someone to attack them. That should make us seek God. Amen. That should make us pray for our leaders. That should make us want to hear this. Vote next year for putting in the best person that would best represent our biblical values. Amen. Because we can't complain if we don't vote. I hear people say, Chris, well, that's all rigged anyway. John Quincy Adams said, God calls us to do our duty, and the results are up to him. Amen? If it's rigged, I don't care. I'm still going to do my best to be a part of the change for godliness. Amen? And we need to do that. Now, it's easy for us to look at the Israelites and say, man, why did they serve these false gods when they had the one true God, Jehovah God? But hear this. We need to make sure that we're not too hard on them as if we don't have the same struggle. Because we do the same thing. Remember, an idol is anything that you put before God. Amen? An idol is anything. That means even good things can be an idol. Let me give you an example of this. You remember Abraham and the promised son of Isaac. Remember when he got the promised son after 25 years of waiting for the promised son? What happened? He was so excited about that promised son that God was sort of going, are you putting this son before me? He didn't say it, but you can see it. And then he said what? Offer him as a sacrifice to see if Abraham was willing to lay down his son for the will of God. How many know that's pretty radical? How many are glad that, you know, the story, the knife did not come down? He said, stop. But there was a knife. How many know that's pretty radical? Imagine being the boy. And a lot of people, we think he's a little boy. He's probably like 25 years old. Can you imagine the son? Hey, Morgan, come on. We're going up and we're gonna sacrifice. Oh, cool, Dad. That's awesome. Let's worship God. And but Dad, where's the sacrifice? You know, can you imagine? And I'm sure, you know, and Morgan will be like, Dad, you're a psycho. But how many know the knife did come down on a son, and it was Jesus Christ? That was a picture of Christ. God did not stop the knife from coming down on his son for you and I. How many are thankful for that? But we need to hear that, is that we idols can be anything we put before God. TV can be an idol. You know, I tell you, I gave up cable, but I'm amazed at how many DVDs happen to come into my house. You know, I don't know what it is. I was raised that TV was my babysitter. I was a little kid. I was left before in front of the TV. Anyone else was like that? I just was left before the TV. So to me, my wife can't stand it. But sometimes if I'm kind of insecure and restless, I'll watch TV. I want to fall asleep to TV. Any weirdos out there like me, or am I the only one? Oh, okay, there's a couple people. No, I don't know. I mean, somebody, they used to a long time ago before I got delivered, right? But and I mean, it can be an idol, even good stuff. It's like the Lord, hear this. Here's how the Lord showed me. If we say, has anyone ever said this? I don't have time to pray. Has anyone said, Lord, I don't have time to read? But boy, oh boy. You know, I want to get one of those Fitbit watches. You ever hear that Fitbit? It does your heart rate, does how much you sleep and all this. How do you know? Wouldn't it be neat if we had a Jesus Bit watch? How much time you spend with God, how much time you spend with your leisure time, wouldn't that be, I mean, that watch would bum us out. And we could look at that, we could look at the graph on our computer and go, I'm a liar. I have a lot of time for what I like to do. I have a lot, I never forget when God said, I've said this to you a million times, but I never forget God said, I said, Lord, I just don't have time. And the Lord goes, I know how to get about an hour, 2 hours every day. How many know the average American watches about 2 hours of TV minimum every day? And now you can count computer in there. Another thing can be an idol is working out. I know in January, right, well, all of us will get memberships to gyms and try to lose that 7 to 10 pounds we gain, and then we'll blow off the gym membership at the end of January. But we'll get that. Isn't it amazing? I mean, I was thinking about that the other day. I was thinking, you know, I said, you know, how much our society is based on looks. Have you noticed that? I was thinking, you know, I always joke about dyeing my hair jet black, but how many know a lot of pastors dye their hair now? And I'm thinking, man, no wonder, maybe I'm just not good at looking enough anymore. I need to get some liposuction and some Elvis hair, you know what I mean? I need to do something here. But how many know that we should be more than just show? There should be some go to us. I'm not saying try to look ugly, but my goodness, our world's kind of gotten a little weird. Do you remember, does anyone remember the days of Billy Crystal? You know? It's not how you feel, it's how you look, and you look marvelous, right? And it's sort of like us today. It doesn't matter what we really are, it matters how we look, right? And I'll tell you, God's more looking at what? The heart than he is our outward appearance. And thank God for that, for me at least. Amen. So the point I'm trying to make is that we don't have idols of that, you know, shiny gold little images of Buddha, but our God is the God of today is a shiny glow of a computer screen, the glow of our smartphones and the glow of our TVs. And I'll tell you guys, we have to hear this, that I was just, you know, I don't know what it is about when I work real hard at the church all day and I put in, you know, pretty long days and I come home, the last thing I want to do is then go read my Bible just for leisure time. And but yet God calls me to do that. I was just praying the other day, just yesterday, and I was praying and I said, Lord, why are you not moving? What am I doing that's grieving you and quenching you? And I was waiting for this big sin that I was blind to. You know what he said to me? It's just real simple. He said, Craig, you're not putting me first. And I think every one of us here could say that honestly. And I just said, well, what do you mean by that? And he says, you know, you made some promises to me that you would sort of turn off the television a little bit and you would seek me a whole lot more. And you've sort of fallen back on that promise. And I'm just trying to remind you that. And here's the verse he gave me. He gave me two verses. He gave me Psalms 91:1. It says, he who dwells in the secret place, meaning getting alone with God. He who dwells in the secret place shall abide of the Almighty, shall abide under the shadow, or he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. How many like the favor of God in your life? Two of you. Okay, the rest of you. Well, but you know, you want the favor of God? Here's what he says. Get alone with me. The secret place. And then he reminded me of how many times Jesus would slip away to a solitary place. He would go away early in the morning, at night. He would go away and he would go, or he'd take his disciples and pray. How many know if it's important to Jesus, it should be important to us. Then he showed me, the last scripture he showed me is Jeremiah 29:13. And it says, when you seek me, you will find me. When you search for me, with all your heart. And there's one little line in there that kind of bugs me. Does it bug you? Key word, with all your heart. And the Lord goes, Craig, you seek me, but not with all your heart. How do I say this to you? I don't know the magic rule, but you know when you're seeking God with all your heart, and you know when you're not. And I will say to my sadness, most of the time, I'm not seeking God with all my heart. I might seek him more than a lot of you, but I can tell God isn't great on a curve. I mean, it's not like college. God grades on, you have to stand before him and you have to say, did you seek the Lord? Did you seek me with all your heart? I want to make sure that God is number one. Amen. You know, I think a lot of times there's God and we have a lot of things. You know, there's a song. What is it, Maureen? It says, there's none beside you. And how many know there's a lot of things beside God in our lives? But how many know this? When things are put here, God's here, things are here. How many know he promises everything will work together for good to those who love him. Remember what he says in Matthew 6:33? Seek first the kingdom of God and all these things. Remember he says, what do the pagans worry about? Food, clothing. No one worries about that today, right? Everyone's secure. Our economy's awesome, right? Do you know the two number one fears in America? Or what is it? Does anyone know? Economy and terrorism. Safety. Now, isn't that neat? Those two things, I was thinking about, the two number one fears can be solved in Jesus. Economy, what? How do you see Malachi 3? Tithe. Give to the Lord, he promises what? To rebuke the devourer and to bless you with such a blessing you can't contain it. There's a promise that you're not bound by the economy of America. But we say, but Pastor Craig, there's no but. Either God's real or he's not. Second is what? The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Psalms 34:7. How many want to have that trust? Amen? But that's what God showed me. God showed me that I, you know, and I think if it's true for me, it's probably true for you guys, is it not? Is that we need to realize that there's other things that hurt God. Because hear this, God is, how many knows? God is trying, he wants to bless us, amen? I was just looking at how much I love my kids, and I want to bless them. Every good parent here want to bless their kids? So I'm thinking, I'm evil, and I want to bless my kids. How much more does a perfect heavenly Father want to bless us? But he will not bless us when we do things the opposite of what he says. It's like he really believes he's God. And he really believes that he should be number one in your life. Not because he's insecure, but because he knows that if anything is equal to him, it's going to mess you up. But when he's in the right place, how many know everything goes better when he's in the right place? Have you ever noticed this? When you put him first, how many know the clock goes a little slower? You notice that? Without God first, your day just goes, your clock. We were watching The Grinch last night, and I mean, you know, the clock that's spinning like this, that's the way my clock goes without God first. How many know what I'm talking about? The clock goes slower. Things go better. I just, all of a sudden, sermons come easier. Everything goes better with Jesus. But when I say, Jesus, I'm too busy, I got to put this first, and then I'll seek you. How do you know? The clock, the life is going to get crazy. I want to tell you guys, there's a reason why the world and Satan fight so hard for you not to put God first. Because Satan knows if you do, you will be blessed. Your family will be in order, and you'll have all that you want. Not want, but need. Amen? And even some of your wants. How many know God is pretty good to us? How many know, in spite of this economy, most of you are going to get what you want this Christmas, unless it's a Learjet, right? Most of you are going to get it, right? I want my little iBit watch. I'm going to get my little iBit watch, right? And most of you are going to get what you want, right? We're not, very few of us cannot get what we want. And if we can't, we'll just rob God to get it. Amen? You get quiet there, didn't you? Almost caught you. Yeah. Oh, no, no, no. That's the first service does that, not you guys. Even though we don't have a first service. But anyways, I better move on. I can say I'm making friends here. I look at your faces. You wonder why it's small. The third year of Jehoiakim would put us around 605 BC, the year Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon Empire, the most powerful ruler not only of that day but probably of all time, is seeking to consolidate his power, and in doing so, he wants to capture Jerusalem. Verse 2, and the Lord gave Jehoiakim, hear this, king of Judah, into his hands. Who gave it? The Lord. Nebuchadnezzar, though he was in control, he thought he was in control, but in fact, he was just a vessel or tool in the hand of God to discipline a rebellious nation or a rebellious king, Jehoiakim, for it was the Lord who gave Jehoiakim into Nebuchadnezzar's hand. Does that concern you again like it concerns me? Because of the rebellion of the people. Hear this, guys. Hear the promise here so you don't have to freak out. Because you go, what about our leader, our government? We can't help that. But hear this, guys. If my people, that's you guys, who are called by my name, will what? Humble themselves and pray and turn what? From their wicked ways. That means you can't just know the truth. You got to turn. Turn from their wicked ways. Then I will what? Forgive their sins. Or seek my face, he says. And I will forgive their sins and heal their land. God wants to do it, but we've got to what? Repent, seek his face, and hear this. This is the hard one. Turn from our wicked ways. Jehoiakim, when the prophet, when God spoke to him, what did he do? He chopped up the word of God. What do a lot of us do? When we hear a scripture we don't like, what do? We just don't read that book, right? I can't believe how many people say this to me. Whenever I talk about something like homosexuality or talk about, you know, alcohol or talk about anything of judgment, they'll say, is that Pauline theology? Did Paul write that? Yeah, Paul wrote about 2/3 of the New Testament. How many know that if Paul wrote it, it's still God? Amen? Because Paul was the one who wrote all scriptures God breathed. We can't pick and choose what scriptures we like. Amen? And so we have to realize that we can't do that. So hear this. Psalms 127, Verse 1 says this, I love this, unless the Lord watches over the city, the watchman stands in guard in vain. We need, you know, I was listening to the presidential debate last Tuesday, and I was watching on YouTube, and how many know they were saying we need, our military is the smallest it's ever been, and I was hearing this, and you hear all this, and how many know that's good to have a strong military, right? It really is important. It's hard, you know, I mean, because a lot of our enemies only understand strength and power. And I could tell you that, but I won't take up time. But we need to have a strong military. But hear this, we need to have a strong favor of God more than that. He doesn't come here now. He's been transferred to, or he comes here every once in a while. But I don't know if you know Jeff Self. But he was the head of border, the head of the whole border patrol. I didn't know how powerful he was. And I was, someone said, you know, Jeff Self, he's in charge of the whole border of Arizona. And I was like, yeah, okay. And I never forget, Mariah and I, we don't have cable. We were watching TV, and all of a sudden I see, this is back a couple years ago, it was President Obama, Janet Napolitano, and then Jeff Self. I mean, I was like, whoa, this guy. I was like, how you doing the next Sunday? I mean, I was like, wow, you know. This guy shakes hands with the president. This guy is a big guy, and he's so humble. How many know Jeff? Does anyone know Jeff? I mean, humble. I'll tell you, some of you guys that are, you know, I mean, he has guys working for him that are more cocky than he is. I mean, the most humble. How many know, when you know who you are, you don't have to be cocky. And he's one of the most humble men I've ever met. But anyway, I say that to say, he said to me, he goes, Craig, you know, you'll say a lot of crazy things, and people kind of go, you know. But he says, whatever you say about the government, he's been working in the government his whole life. He says, times it by 20 and you're almost getting it. This is a guy who's in the government, who's the head, who's now getting punished for following Christ in this government. But he's saying is, we're just babysitting. We're not really on the border. We're just kind of there as a presence, but we're really not going after it. It's just kind of like we move this side and then they come this way. We move over here and they come. We're not taking it serious. Now, how many know when you have the head of the Border Patrol saying that to you, how many know you and I should be very concerned? And when he tells me the only reason we don't have an attack in America is because of the grace and mercy of God. So I tell you, people, not to scare you, but hopefully to motivate you to seek first the kingdom of God and say, God, what's going to keep some terrorist guy coming in this church or coming into our homes or coming into the restaurant we're eating is the mercy and grace of God because we've put him first in our lives. Amen? It's not your gun, right? You know, most of us be like Barney Fife. We'd be putting our, you know, I mean, you know what I mean? I talk real tough at the range, but we get up, you know what I mean? We need the Lord's protection. We need the Lord's protection. I'm not saying I'm not putting down guns. Don't hear that. But I'm saying the first defense is God. Amen? And we need to do that. And so you see Jehoiakim didn't do that, and he was handed over by God to Nebuchadnezzar, an enemy. And I don't want to see this country be handed over. Amen? At least on my watch. I really don't. Middle of verse 2. With some of the articles of the house of God, which he carried, Nebuchadnezzar carried into the land of Shinar to the household of God, his God, and he brought the articles, the temple articles, into the treasure house of his God. Verse 3, then the king instructed Aspenaz, I can't say his words, then the master of the eunuchs, to bring some of the children of Israel and some of the king's descendants and some of the nobles. Verse 4, young men in whom there was no blemish, but good looking, gifted in all wisdom, possessing knowledge, and quick to understand, who had ability to serve in the king's palace, and whom they might teach the language and literature of the Chaldeans, or you could say the Babylonians. In his first attack, King Nebuchadnezzar didn't destroy Jerusalem. He simply took the treasures of the temple. He took the articles of the temple, like the vessels and things like that, and as well as the cream of the crop of young men of Jerusalem. He made them eunuchs in order that they might study without distraction. I mean, that would be a good thing if we could do that today. Amen? Some of your young kids go, no. But it would be neat if you could just switch that off, right? If you could switch the sex drive off until you can get married. Wouldn't that be a good thing, seriously? Some of you parents know what I'm talking about. It'd be a neat thing if you could just switch it off, right? But then they say this. I heard this stat. If the sex drive of a man wasn't that as strong as it is, they would never get married. Amen? So it's what helps men to get married is that drive. And so, but anyways, I thought it would be kind of cool if you could switch it off, but God said no. Then he educated them, King Nebuchadnezzar, he educated them in the laws of science and knowledge and preparation to become administrators throughout his kingdom, his empire. As seen here, sin, I want us to see here, sin always leads to two things. The first thing sin leads to is first is blasphemy. The instruments used in the temple of the Jehovah God to worship the true and living God were now being carried away to Babylon and placed in the immoral, idolatrous temple of the false gods of Babylon. Hear this, guys. Sin invariably causes people to feel blasphemous towards God. Do you notice that? Have you noticed how atheists feel about God? I mean, and I said last week, isn't it funny? A God they say doesn't exist, how contemptuous they are to this God that doesn't exist. Why is that? Why do they hate this boogeyman God? They say he doesn't real, but they just hate this boogeyman that doesn't real. How many know I do not hate the boogeyman? Because I really don't believe he exists. Amen? I believe demons exist, but not the boogeyman. How many know? I don't believe it, so I don't hate it. But when someone hates God that they don't believe in, how many know? They do believe in God. They're just what it says in Psalms 14:1 that says what? The fool says in his heart, there is no God. Willful ignorance. Willful. It says in 2 Peter 3, I believe, 3 something. It says that they are willfully ignorant. They say, I choose. They're like this. La, 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 la. Do not confuse me with the facts. I've made up my mind. There's no God. There are very few. When I used to do my talk, I had a call-in radio show, and I really used to believe there were sincere atheists, sincere agnostics, but most of them are willfully ignorant. How many know that? I would always say, they'd say, so what about the pygmies in Africa? How come about that? Why does a loving God allow that to people to starve and die without God? How could this be? I go, here's what you do. You get saved and you can become a missionary and help the pygmies. Click. Because they really don't care about the pygmies. They just use it as a smokescreen to divert why they need Jesus. So blasphemous. Second, sin always leads, hear this, to bondage. The people of God were being carried away in chains to Babylon because of their sin and rebellion to God. That's what sin does. It has a way of ensnaring and trapping us. Hear this, guys. I want to tell you this. As I said, the older you get, hopefully the more. They say the older you get, the more conservative you get. The older you get, hopefully the more you realize that when the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, you believe that. Hopefully you believe what it says in Galatians 6 that says, what he who sows to the flesh will reap what? Corruption, death. But he who sows to the spirit will reap what? Life. How many want life? Then we need to hate sin, right? We don't hate sinners, but we hate sin because we know what sin does. It traps. It ensnares. Hear this. I've told you this before, Ted Bundy. How many have heard of Ted Bundy, the serial killer? Killed, they say, over 30 women. The 30 women they know of for sure, but over 30 probably because they believe there was like 10 or 15 more maybe that they didn't say. I was around that. That really touched me because I was right by the place where he killed two girls. I literally was a youth pastor like a mile away from it, 2 miles away. It was pretty wild. I water skied over where they got some of the bodies out. It was pretty freaky to me, Lake Sammamish in Seattle. But hear this. Ted Bundy did not start looking at pornography with his uncle or stealing his uncle's Playboys thinking, someday, you know what, I'm going to grow up to be an infamous rapist and serial killer. He thought, I'm just going to look at Playboy. I'm just going to be like every other boy. You know, everyone's doing it. I'm just going to look at this pornography and I'll be able to control it and it'll be fine. How many know that's the way sin is? I used to say in the schools, no one grows up to say, I'm going to be the next Ted Bundy. No one grows up to say, hey, I'm going to start smoking weed in high school, and someday I'm going to be a heroin addict, and I'm going to be living on the streets like a transit. Nobody says that. Nobody desires that, but that's what sin does. Nobody starts drinking in high school and says, you know what, I'm going to be a raging alcoholic and destroy my life and my family. Nobody does that. But that's what sin does. And we need to learn to hate sin. And hear this, young people, learn to hate sin now so you don't have to be ravaged by sin. Amen? Learn to say, you know, we're merciful on sinners. We want to help sinners, but we want to hate sin. We don't coddle sin. Amen? Because it destroys people. It destroys people. We're going to see what fine young men these four boys were. Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. They were physically strong. They were handsome. They were socially graceful. They were well-liked by others. They were mentally smart. They were well-educated. And totally, hear this is the best quality. They were totally devoted to God. And they were teenagers. How many know to have a godly teenager is a pretty amazing thing in this day and age? Amen? It is an amazing thing. It's a rare thing. And we should celebrate that we have some godly young people in this church. Amen? Can we clap for that? Praise the Lord. Their lives were blessed, as we see. Their lives were like that of Christ. I like what it says about Jesus in Luke 2:52. It says this: Jesus grew as when he was a child. It says Jesus grew in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and all the people. How many like that for your kid? Grow in stature, grow in wisdom, grow in favor, not compromise, but favor with God and all the people. They, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and Daniel were perfect examples of godly teenagers. But now, hear this. They're going to have a difficult time, a difficult trial lies ahead of them. The king wanted to now, has taken them into a foreign land, and now wants to force them to conform to the ways of Babylon. He was not just interested in putting good Jewish boys to work for his kingdom. Hear this. He wanted these boys to be Babylonians. He wanted to convert them to be Babylonians. We as Christians today face the same trial, do we not? Satan wants us to become conform to his image, conform to the world. Do you not see it? You know what Kevin was saying to me? You can hate Kevin for this. Everyone look at Kevin. He's in the back there. But Kevin said this, that it's amazing how much worldliness is in our TV and in our movies. Do you notice that? Do you see the agenda for homosexuality? Do you see the PC that we should never have? You're not one of those born again Christians. You can see a constant pressure to be conformed to this world, to think like this world thinks. How many know? Hear this, guys. If you want to be, how many wants to be Christ-like? Raise your hand. There you go. Hopefully every one of you. But hear this. Your Lord and your Savior spoke the truth in love. Did he not? Did he not speak the truth perfectly in love? But he spoke it so perfect, so lovingly, but yet so clear that people of this world killed him. You know what? I think of myself as a pretty bold preacher for this day and age. But how many know I'm nothing? I've had death threats, but by the grace of God, I've never had anyone mad enough to kill me. How many know our Lord spoke so clear? And I always think it's funny when people say, Craig, you shouldn't talk about other people. You shouldn't get people back. What are you doing? Jesus never did that, did he? No. Yeah, Pharisees, you're your father, the devil. But I say it in love. You know, I mean, come on. Can you imagine? You brood of vipers, you whitewashed tombs, who warned you to flee from the coming earth? Jesus said that too, not just John the Baptist. You hypocrites. If you're hypocrites, hey, disciples, if your righteousness does not exceed that of these hypocrite Pharisees, you will not enter the kingdom of God. Do you think the Pharisees went, I just love Jesus. I just love him. Oh, don't you feel the mercy when he says we're going to the hell? Don't you love that? Now you would say, well, that's Jesus, but come on. You know what I mean? We're living in a PC age to where, hear this, they say, and I'm going to say it again until you guys change. It's more judgmental. I get judged harder talking about the adulterer or the fornicating pastor or the adulterous pastor than I do than being the adulterous pastor. How many know something's wrong with that? How many know the Bible talks about church discipline? I can get more trouble sued and in trouble by you guys if I talk the way the Bible says about how we're to deal with sin. We've got to say, I'm in this world, but I'm not going to be of this world. Amen? Amen? And I need to have my mind renewed, and I need to say some things. And guess what? You speak the truth in love. You say that there are radical terrorist Muslims that want to kill us. I mean, you know, Islamophobic. I don't know who it was who said, you know what? This kind of PC stuff is going to kill us. How many know the devil just laughs? Oh, they're so stupid. They're so PC. You know? Was Jesus PC? Really? Was Paul PC? They spoke the truth in love, and they let the chips fall where they may. Amen? They let the chips fall where they may. And we got to get to that place where we say, did I say something that wasn't true? If I say something in this pulpit, hear this, I didn't ask if I say something that offends you. That's not what I asked. I asked, if I say something that isn't true, then I welcome you to say, Craig, that's a false statement. Or that's not in the Word of God. If I do that, I welcome it. But if you go, I really don't appreciate your style of just saying whatever you feel, that's just wrong. I don't like feeling, you know, ooh, everyone's all, ooh, I don't like that. Why can't you be more like Joel Osteen? What's wrong with you?
Because we don't need more coddling, amen? When your kid's bad, you don't say, you know what? You are so bad, you poked your sister in the eye, now you're getting an ice cream. You don't do that. You discipline them if you want your kid not to be a monster, amen? And then sometimes we need to hear the bad news before we can really appreciate the good news. And I'm saying this to you because, guys, I want you to be holy as Christ is holy. I want you to be a pleasing people. I want you not just to, have you noticed this, guys? We say we're Christians, but our lives aren't much different than the world. Our family problems are the same. We have alcohol. We have struggle with drugs. We have sexual morality. We have everything just like the world. And how many know we should be different? Why would anyone want our Christianity? Didn't say Jesus, but our Christianity. You know why I think it's so hard for us to make disciples today? Because we don't want anyone following us. Remember what Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. But oh, don't look at that, and don't look how I drive, and don't look what I do when people cut me off. Don't look at that. But how many know we need to start living lives to where we could have people. We could say, hey, follow me. Hang out with me. And they're not freaked out at the end of the day. They're more impressed. Wouldn't you like to be like that? I want to be, I've never been this. I mean, I'm almost as big as an iceberg. But how many know? They say an iceberg is 2/10 out of the water, 8/10 under the water. How many know? I like to be deeper than you see in the Lord. I would like to have more depth than when you get around me, you go, oh my goodness, Craig is more godly than I thought he was, not less. But here's the sad thing. Most of you hang out with me for a day, you're like, you're a pastor? Really? But don't get up with you. I'd say the same about you. You're a Christian? Seriously? Where was I? Satan wants to conform us to this world, but hear this, Romans 12:1, most of you know this, and 2. Here's what, I like the J.B. Phillips how it says it. J.B. Phillips says it so cool. He's a guy who wrote the New Testament. He kind of translated it. He's from England, so he's from jolly old England. And here's what he says, Romans 12:1 and 2. He says, with eyes wide open to the mercies of God, I beg you, my brothers, as an act of intelligent worship, give him, God, your bodies as a living sacrifice, consecrated or set apart to him and accepted by him. Hear this. This is what I want you to hear right here. This is what I love. Don't let the world around you squeeze you into its own mold. How many can say you feel that? Don't let the world squeeze you, press you, right? There's no peer pressure, right, kids? No pressure in high school. No pressure on, you know, hanging out at work, right? No pressure. But he says, don't let the world squeeze you in its mold, but let God remold your minds from within. But hear this, guys. If the only word you're getting is me once a week, how many know that's not very much? How many know this? You guys go,
Craig, you preach for an hour. You know that, don't you?
How many know? None of you, I've never seen one of you, or maybe I don't watch you in the movies, but I don't think too many of you have gone. Watch the Titanic. What was that, like 4 hours, nine? The longest movie I ever went to. But that movie.
Girls go, it was precious.
No, it wasn't. You know, any grandma throws a big diamond over the thing, I'm hmm. But anyway, but yeah, I want to throw grandma. No, okay, I'm just kidding. No, that's not right. That's not PC, I'll tell you that right now. But I don't even remember what I was saying there. What was that? Oh, but the pressure. Right? But none of you have said,
Excuse me, back to the counter. That was too long. I need my money back.
But boy, if a sermon goes an hour, I got to go potty. Hello. Do you realize the Puritans, the early Puritans, preached an hour to 3 hours in the start of this country? And I think they were a little more moral than we were. What do you bet? A little less temptation, what do you bet? I mean, they still had temptation, but not like we. Remember, sin will abound in the last days, and it is. But hear this. If they need an hour to 3 hours, how many know you could at least should have an hour? Because you need your minds renewed. You need your brains washed by the water of the word. Amen. Because we get, you don't realize how much you get hit, right? You saw it at your college, did you not this week? Their college, right here, I'm saying Liberty College right here. But their college, how many of their professor goes, or the professor, their dean, Jerry Falwell Jr. got up and said, hey, we need to carry some guns so Muslims trying to mess with us. Well, hey, we'll be ready. How many of that went over really good? Hillary loved that. Hillary's like, praise the Lord, right? Hillary's like, oh, yeah. I mean, you know, she was so angry. But how many know we can't let people pressure us into saying what is, quote, politically correct. Here's my only pressure I have. Is did this please you, God, what I said? How many know it's a lot easier when you have one, an audience of one? We used to say that in football, right? An audience of one. How many know really that's the only one you should be worrying about? Am I pleasing God? And Jesus said, if they love me, they're going to love you. If they hate me, they're going to hate you. So just know that. And hear this. Here's the part that helps me do this. If you try to please both sides, you'll end up pleasing what? No one. I'd rather be on the side of the Lord and please one master, and that's God and those who love him. Amen? Sad to say that too many Christians give in to the world and lose their power in the Lord because of giving into the world and being defiled. And they lose their joy of the Lord because of the sin they allow in their life. And sad, a lot of Christians hear this, they ultimately lose their witness or testimony. I never forget, I was at La Paloma, and I was a doorman, and I never forget this guy was a Christian, and he went, one night he went out with the guys to a strip club and got drunk. How many of the guys said, oh, we'll accept you, we'll love you. Oh, okay. How many of the next day that he was the mockery of La Paloma? The world will say, oh, come with us. Oh, come and be part of us. Oh, minister to us. But then once you cross that line, ha-ha! And how many know he lost his witness? He eventually quit because it was so bad and so hard for him. Note the hard changes that these young men had to experience and face. They were no longer, hear this, surrounded by the things of God in their homeland, in Jerusalem. And no longer would they have the influence of their priest. Right then they had a priest, remember back in the Old Testament, and their parents and their teachers. Hear this, how many know that except for this place, how many know there's not too many safe places in this world? How many know the grocery store isn't that safe to speak the truth? How many know your work isn't safe a lot of times? And, you know, definitely political arena is pretty not popular to be conservative Christian. But how many know we should be able to be safe here, amen? We should say we want the truth here, and we should get bold enough. Hear this, guys. Ted Cruz said he's waiting for all those conservatives that are disillusioned to come out and stand up and speak the truth again. I'll tell you guys, in one way, I'm very sad of the way our world's going, our country, but I'm also very excited because as one man of God said, God is drawing a line in the sand and you're going to know what church is really his and what church is not. And it's going to get more and more cleared. Right now, it's sort of muddled, isn't it? Because we're sort of like, well, aren't we all, if we just say the name Jesus, we're all in it. How do we know? It's getting clear. It's not. Churches that do same-sex marriages, churches that say Jesus is a way, churches do not believe in the virgin birth, those are not, they might have the name Jesus, but that does not mean they're Christian. Amen? And we have to say that. Now, I know it's hard for some of you, but it's the truth. Jesus said, not all that call me Lord, Lord will enter the kingdom of God. They were no longer, but they didn't have the influence of their parents and teachers. Hear this, 75% of young Christian men will sadly fall away from the Lord their freshman year in college. Did you hear that? 75%. If you're not sure that
college is sort of anti-Christian, a lot of them. What would make this 75? Because there's such, has anyone been in a college class lately? It's really cool to love God, isn't it? Don't they praise you for that? Hey, bonehead, yeah, if you want to love God, if you want to be retarded, sure, go for it. Isn't that the way it's said? I mean, I used to get in fight. I went to U of A in 86 for a year, and I mean, I would get in fight. I can't imagine. I would be kicked out of the U of A today. And I mean, it was just constant battle. And I couldn't believe how a lot of these professors would say things that weren't even, they're just crazy. It was just anger. But it wasn't even educated. I could debate them. And I was a young kid. I was only 24 years old. And I could stand with them. Because a lot of what they said was insane. As I just quoted, that some of the Christian young men and women get away, when they get away from home, they rejoice in the chance to let down their guard and to get caught up in the things of this world. But hear this, Hebrews 11:24 says this. I love this. It says this, stay with me, because this is, it's going to get good here, I promise. All the rest is, yeah. But anyway, no. The word's good, but just me. It was by faith that Moses, when he grew up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, which Egypt is a picture of what? The world. Verse 25, he chose, hear that, it's a choice. He chose to share the oppression of God's people instead of enjoying the fleeting pleasures of sin. Verse 26, he thought it was better to suffer for the sake of Christ than to own the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking ahead to his great reward. Hear this, guys. Notice what it says in verse 25, the fleeting pleasures of sin. Hear this, sin is pleasurable. It is. Anyone says it's not is a liar. But hear this, it's fleeting. Amen? It's fleeting. And how many know, I don't know if you remember the old Boss Skaggs song, you better bring the check around. How many know, when you bring the check around, it's expensive. I'll never forget, and I'm sorry some of you get mad at this, but I used to sell cocaine, and I used to do cocaine, and I look sometimes, and I can't believe how costly sin is. And you know, sweet and low? That's a gram. Okay, that's pretty small. You know how much that sold for back in the 80s? $120. How many know that's fleeting pleasure? Expensive, fleeting pleasure. And that's the way sin is. Oh, it's pleasurable for a second, but in the end it what? Brings death. It brings corruption. And whenever the devil tries to remind me of the good old days, the Lord goes, if it was so good, why did you almost kill yourself? And the world was good to me. It was, in the sense of outward stuff, it was good to me, but I was empty inside. I love what Ravi Zacharias said. He said, it's not pain that disillusions you. It's having everything and still having nothing, being empty. And a lot of us have it. Do you know suicide is higher in Oro Valley, in Northwest Tucson, in the richer areas than it is in the poor areas? You know why that is? Because the kids in the South Side think, if only I could make it to Oro Valley, then I'll be happy. But the kids in Oro Valley have everything and they go, I'm still not happy. I'm still not fulfilled. As Kevin said, let's believe the truth that we don't need the iBit to be happy. We don't need a new computer to be happy. We don't need a new hairdo, right? Jet black, to be happy. We need Jesus and to put him first to truly be fulfilled and happy. Amen? I believe this. Then most people sin because they forget God is real. Amen? We get so busy with life, right? We're getting shopping. We forget the reason for the season. Oh yes, it's about Jesus. Right? I was watching The Grinch last night, and even The Grinch goes, oh, the meaning of Christmas is family. Hello, Christ Mass, Christmas. It's not just family. Amen? Jesus is the reason for Christmas. You know, I want to do a new rule here since we're PC society. If you don't like Christ, if you're a Muslim or an atheist, you don't get the holiday off. I mean, no, that would change. I love Jesus. He's awesome. Some of you are like, that's just mean. because they forget God is real, and they forget that they're going to stand before him someday and give an account for their life. Do you notice when people sin in the Bible, a lot of times it says what? They forgot the fear of the Lord. They don't believe. We forget. We're so busy. How many of Satan keeps us running? Just that we forget that God is real. And we forget that we're going to actually stand before him someday. You're going to die one day or be raptured one day. And you're going to stand before God and give an account for everything you said, everything you did, and every reason you didn't do something, you did do something. And you're going to not be able to lawyer up. But this was not the case with Daniel and his friends. How many of you know that we need a godly revolution today? We need a godly rebellion. I love what A.W. Tozer, a godly man, said. He goes, I will rebel against anything that comes between God and me. Amen? Amen. You know, Black Power, Panther. How many know? Jesus power. I rebel against this world. Woo! There you go, Don, right there. Hey, come on. Power to the people. Let's go, baby. Come on. You know, I rebel. And you know, we need that. We need a holy, godly revolution. I'm not talking, did you hear? I didn't say pick up weapons. I didn't say that. But we need to rebel against this world. We need kids who no longer rebel against God and even adults, but instead they rebel against this world, against the PC correctness, against its ungodly ways, and they'll say, no, we won't go. And they'll say, no more. We have, everyone's protesting everything. Why can't Christians say, I protest the world? Amen. I protest the pressure of this world. I protest that, do you remember Tim Tebow just this week, or 2 weeks ago, Tim Tebow, you know Tim Tebow, the Christian football? He was dating Miss whatever universe, and she said, oh, she dumped him because he wouldn't have sex with her. And everyone's mocking him. What's your problem? Can't get it through the field goal? I want to rebel against a world that says you have to have sex with everyone you can because you're Tim Tebow. I want to say that why? And people are saying, why are you rejecting this person's religion? You never do this to a Muslim. You never say, what? Why can't you eat a ham sandwich? What's wrong with you, boy? But yet to someone who wants to be wait and to not have sex until marriage, we put them down. And we don't say how wrong that is. And we need to start saying enough. Enough, enough, enough. What was the statistics, Kevin? I'm stealing your message for next week. But how many Christians thought it was all right to have premarital sex? 61% of Christians believe it's all right to have premarital sex because it's none of your business, Pastor, what I do. How many know it isn't my business, but it's God's business? And God says, fornicators shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Oops.
Well, but I'm just a loving fornicator. I don't do it.
I'm making friends, aren't I? One of you should give me the book, How to Make Friends and Influence People, by that guy, But am I telling the truth? Daniel 1:8, I'm skipping ahead here. But Daniel was, hear this, determined, the New Living says, or King James says, he purposed in his heart not to defile himself. How many know we need to do that? We need a purpose in our hearts to not defile ourselves. Because if you don't purpose now, when you're in the backseat of a car, you will defile yourself. You need to make decisions now when you're in church, when you're hearing the voice of God, hopefully speaking through his word, not me, I'm not saying the voice of God, but when you hear it, you need to make a determination, I will not be defiled. Amen? I will not go along with the world. I will not be at work and someone says, you're not one of those Christians that believes that homosexuality is wrong, are you?
Yes, I am one of those because the Bible says it.
I always love when people get mad at me. I say, this is what the Bible says. Your fight is with God, not with me. But here, what did Jesus say? Think about this. I don't know about you, agree. But when we don't stand for that, what did Jesus say? All scripture is God-breathed. Jesus is the word become flesh. What did Jesus say? If you deny me before man, I will what? Isn't that a form of denial of Jesus? Is it not? Amen. I'm taking the silences. Is it not? Is it not when your friends are fornicating and you see that it says fornicators also should not inherit the kingdom of God? Now hear this, guys. If you fornicated or if you've committed adultery or if you've been homosexual, how many know there's grace? But not in continued sin. And remember what it says in 1 Corinthians 6:11, it says such were some of you. How many know we need the were back in Jesus? Not still are, not continuing in, but were. I used to be a fornicator. But now that's the old Craig. Amen? I used to be a drug dealer. That is the old. Some of you say, oh, don't say that. Why do you say that? Because that's the old Craig. That's like talking about Abraham Lincoln. It's not me. Now, some of you can't talk about it because it's still. I want to ask you this. Is there an area of your life that you're being defiled in today? I'm not going to ask you to say it out loud, so don't get nervous. But is there an area or areas of your life where you're being defiled, which is to be mixed, a part of the world, part of Jesus? James said, to love this world is to be an enemy of God. But hear this, guys. Victory begins when you and I purpose in our hearts to make a decision to say, no more. And I want to tell you this, guys. I wish God would just open my head and pour in godliness and it's all done. But sometimes, how many know, I have to, like Daniel, and you have to make a purpose. You have to determine in your heart, and you have to purpose in your heart that I am tired of being defiled. I am tired of being part of the world. I am tired of having the world have more effect on me than Christ and me having effect in the world. How many of you today, with every head open, every eye open, and every head up, how many of you today would say, I want to be like Daniel, and purpose in my heart to be set apart. Amen. Amen? Hopefully every one of us. Purpose in our hearts to be set apart. To say, God, I'm not going to, by your grace and strength, and here's, I'm not saying boast in yourself, but I'm saying, God, how many know God wants you to be set apart? How many know God wants you to be holy as he's holy? He says, without holiness, no one shall see God, it says in Hebrews. He wants you to be holy, but we have to partner with him to say, I determine, I purpose to be holy. And I'm going to tell you this, guys, it's going to cost you in this day and age. And as we're going to see in the study of Daniel, it could have cost them dearly. And it almost did, right? The fiery furnace. But when you stand for God, you got to be able to say like Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, well, the three, it wasn't Daniel there, but Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, you got to say, my God can deliver me from this fiery furnace, but if he doesn't, we will still not bow our knee to you. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this day, and I thank you for all the hands that raised. And I pray that, Father, that, Lord, that would be true. It wouldn't just be emotionality. It wouldn't just be the heat of the moment, but it would truly be our heart's cry that we would say, Lord, we're tired of being defiled by this world. We're tired about the movies we watch that go against you and what is true and right. We're tired of listening to things from other people that we shouldn't. We're tired of going along with people at work when they say things that are contrary to you and your word or against you and your word. God, help us, Lord. We don't want to be obnoxious, but we want to be, as you said, the righteous are as bold as a lion. Help us, Lord, to be bold men and women of God. Help us and help us to see that the way we're going to be bold is we're not, the devil doesn't have anything in us. As you said, Jesus, Satan, the prince, the god of this world has tried me, but he has nothing in me. May it be the heart's desire of every one of us here that Satan has nothing in us. Amen. Nothing in us. No pornography, no fornication, no adultery, no robbing God by our giving, no not allowing any areas of defilement in our life. Let us allow you to sanctify us. Let us allow you to hear the 2 Timothy 2:24 that says, in a house there's many vessels, some of noble purposes, some of ignoble. But if a man, you said, will cleanse himself from the latter, from sin, if he'll cleanse himself from being filled with junk and a garbage disposal, if he'll cleanse himself and let himself be a vessel of honor, then he will be a vessel fit. He'll be a vessel of honor fit for every good work. And I pray that everyone here, old, young, middle-aged, will want to be that vessel of honor. Amen? To where you are free to flow in and through. And then, Lord, when we struggle and we stumble, thank you that there is grace. But Lord, let us see that if we fornicate with our boyfriend or girlfriend for a year, that's not a whoopsie. That's willful sin. That's willful defilement. And I pray, God, that you would convict us of that, that you would show us that those are the things that grieve you. Those are the things that take away our joy, that take away our witness, that take away the power of you flowing in and through us. So God, I pray that you'll sanctify this body. I pray, oh God, that this church would not just be filled with a lot of people, but it would be filled with as many people as you deem fit that want you on your terms. Amen? That want to live for you, that want to be holy, that want the truth spoken in love, but yet sometimes firmly, that they would say, God, I am tired of this world. I am tired of Babylon. And I want to live for you. I want to stand with you, even if it means standing alone, because I'd rather stand. You said it's better to be what? With a minority with God than to be with the whole world and lose your soul. So God, give us the courage. Give us the strength. And let us, as I end this, let us remember that part of the people who were thrown in the lake of fire was one of the biggest things, and I never saw this until a couple years ago, but one of the things, the people that are thrown in the lake of fire for all eternity, is the cowardice. Cowards. Help us, Lord, not to be cowards in these last days. Amen? Amen. But give us your courage. Give us your strength. Give us a Holy Ghost boldness to speak the word of God in love, but yet boldly, and not compromise it, so that we do not grieve you or quench you. But if anything, if anyone's going to be grieved or quenched, it's going to be this world in our lives and in our families. I pray this, and we believe for this, because we ask it in the most powerful, almighty name, the name above all names, the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And everyone agreed, gave a loud football stadium, amen. Amen. Whew. All right, you may stand. God bless you guys.